Now that we've diagonalized the derivative and the second derivative operators, we get to our punchline, Fourier series. We're going to see how to take any periodic function and decompose it. And here's the deal. There are two versions of it. One is sine and cosine series. And if you have a periodic function with period L, then you can always express it in terms of sines and cosines. You can write it as a constant, which for some reason we write as a0 divided by 2. And then we have a sum of cosine terms, where n goes from 1 to infinity. We have a sum of sine terms, where n goes from 1 to infinity. The frequencies are all multiples of 2 pi over L. Okay? And the coefficients are, the ans are given by this formula. It's 2 over L, the integral of f of x times the cosine of 2 pi n x over L. That includes the formula for a0. And bn is given by the 2 over L times the integral of f of x times the sine of 2 pi n x over L. So that's one version of Fourier series. Now, the reason for that is because we worked out what are all the eigenfunctions of the second derivative. The eigenfunctions of the second derivative were the constant function 1, which we can think of as cosine of 2 pi 0 x over L, and then the cosines of 2 pi n x over L, and the sines of 2 pi n x over L. So we have these functions starting from n equals 0, and these functions starting from n equals 1. And because the eigenvalues are because this is a Hermitian operator, these are all orthogonal. And you can work out the inner product of any one of these with itself, whether it's a cosine or a sine. We'll use xi for the cosines and chi for the sines. The inner product of anything with itself works out to L over 2 if n is bigger than 0. And the constant function 1, inner product with itself, is L rather than L over 2. And the fact that it's L rather than L over 2 is why you get this particular a0 over 2 instead of a0. Okay, so the coefficient of xi n is going to be the inner product of xi n with f divided by the inner product of xi n with itself. And that gives you 2 over L times the inner product times the integral of cosine 2 pi n x over L times f, if n is bigger than 0. It gives you 1 over L times the integral of cosine of 0 x times f, if n is 0, because the inner product of this with itself is L instead of L over 2. And so we don't call this a0, we call this a0 over 2. The coefficient of chi n is the same thing, only you use chi's instead of xi's. And you get that integral. So the formulas for an and bn are just our usual formulas for taking inner products. Whenever you have an orthogonal basis, you can figure out the coefficients by taking inner products. And in this space, the inner product is an integral because our space is L2. All right. So that's one kind of Fourier series. The other kind of Fourier series uses complex exponentials. You write an arbitrary periodic function as a sum of coefficients times e to the 2 pi I n x over L, where now n doesn't go from 0 to infinity or 1 to infinity, it goes from minus infinity to infinity. It's a doubly infinite sum. And if you prefer, you can split this up as a cosine plus I sine piece, and you see the same functions, cosine and sine, that we did in version 1. And what are our cn's? It's just the integrals of e to the minus 2 pi I n x over L times f of x dx, divided by L. Now the reason is we're using eigenfunctions not of the second derivative, but of the first derivative, minus I d by dx. These give you a nice orthogonal basis because minus I d by dx is Hermitian. And so if you want to expand in this basis, you can expand anything in this basis. That's what this expression is telling you. It's a linear combination of the basis vectors. And the coefficient of each basis vector is just the inner product of that with your function divided by the inner product of that with itself. Inner product of that with itself is L. Inner product of that with the function, you have to take e to the 2 pi I n x over L and conjugate it. Conjugating the function converts the e to the plus 2 pi I n x over L to e to the minus 2 pi I n x over L. And there's our formula. Okay. Now, the second kind is actually in some ways the more fundamental one. It's more flexible than the sine and cosine. The disadvantage is you have to use complex numbers. But the advantage is that the sine and cosine is well suited for problems involving second derivatives because there's diagonalizing a second derivative operator. This is good for problems involving first derivatives. You often use a hat to, you know, you run out of letters of the alphabet quickly enough. So you often write f hat n for the nth term when you expand f, and then we'd have g hat n when you expand g, and h hat n when you expand h. If you have any function, you put a hat on it, and you take the subscript n, and that means the nth coefficient when you expand it this way, and that's called the Fourier coefficient of f. So another way to say what we've done is we've written an arbitrary function on our vector space, arbitrary vector in our vector space, as a linear combination of constants times basis vectors. How do you get the constants? You take 1 over L times the inner product of the basis vector with F. And then if you want the inner product of two functions, F with G, it's a doubly infinite sum, 1 over N, 1 over M. But BN and BM are orthogonal unless N equals M. So the only terms that come out are the terms where N equals M. And a very special case of this is when you take the inner product of f with itself. Because then you get the nth Fourier coefficient of f squared. So the Fourier coefficients give you something that's square summable as long as f is square integrable. If it's summable, if this sum converges, the f hats have got to decay as n goes to infinity or as n goes to minus infinity. The question is, how fast? That's what we're going to explore in our next video. We're going to see that smooth functions have Fourier series that decay very, very quickly, and so you only need a few terms to get a very accurate representation of the function, while rough functions require more data.